If you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Luke. Luke chapter number 9. Next Sunday, we'll be celebrating Pastor Michael and his family into their next season of ministry. God has taken them to be with family up in Nashville, Tennessee. And you heard it in the announcements, but I want to make sure it's very clear. Next Sunday, we'll celebrate inside of the service. But then from 4 to 6:30 p.m., we'll be at the Gridiron Restaurant right off of Tryon. It's about 5 miles from here going back towards the South Carolina line. We'll be there with light hors d'oeuvres. If you have any, I encourage all of you to join Em and I with an appreciation if you want to give them gift cards or our money. Kelly really enjoys money, specifically as it pertains to pedicures and manicures. Did I say everything you needed me to say? Okay. She likes Cato as well. Okay, so I'm just being serious. I do want you to show your love and appreciation. They have been a huge blessing to us. And you know, Goins, Pastor Michael, he's a childhood friend. So I have been dealing professionally with this for weeks, and I'm starting to feel the personal side roll up on me. And you know, that's my boy. And so I'm gonna probably kill him while I'm in Honduras this week, or at least hurt him really good. Maybe not kill him because you probably want to see him. How's the life insurance? It's pretty good. Oh, he's dead. Oh, he's dead. Just tithe it. I got a building to build. I'm just being serious. No, I'm gonna enjoy the week that I get to be with him, and hopefully, you know, it's going to be beautiful. But join us next Sunday over at the Gridiron, and let's show our love and support and appreciation for the things they have done. And I just believe that this is an extension. We're now moving from just being in Charlotte to now being extended to Nashville. You understand what I'm saying? That this is not goodbye. This is just, we got a little more distance. Okay. Occupying some more territory. And just let me be, just in case, because I know some of us, I'm taking a lot of time, but I promise you I have a short message. I'm taking a little time, but I just want you to know, those of you that came out of church hurt, it's real easy to just go, well, you know, that's just a story. Well, that's the story I know. And the first step of the vision of Judah Church is that we are real. And I asked Pastor Michael, I said, so tell me why you're leaving. And then he told me what he told you from the pulpit a couple weeks back. I said, now, there's no other story, right? I mean, because if I'm a scoundrel, I'm hard to get along with, I'm a slave driver, I'm cheap. Let's just tell everybody exactly what it is. I'm just a piece of whatever you need to articulate. And let's just tell everybody exactly what it is, because if we're going to do anything in this church, we're going to be real. Amen. Hallelujah. And so, you know, if you find a new scoop, don't let me know. It's none of my business what you think. But that's the story as I understand it. And so I just want you to know that I'm not going to communicate a story that is it is manipulative to you, because I don't think you're big enough to handle it. Been there, done that. I'm not going there no more. Hey, Luke chapter number 9. Luke chapter number 9. We are in a series entitled See Vision Run. And again, I will preface this message by saying that if you limit this to just money, you're missing the point and the power of having vision. The Bible says that without vision, people cast off restraints. They perish. There are people that die, and there are people that live completely unrestrained with just crazy stuff going on because there is no real vision for their life. For without a vision, people perish. People are dying in churches not because they're bad, but because there's no vision. People are unrestrained and chaos has ensued because people are without vision. If there's nonsense going on in your home and people are unrestrained in your home, I submit to you that it's not because they're rebellious. It may just be they're not clear with where it is that you're trying to go as a family. For without vision, people perish. But I want to give a disclaimer in this message this morning, and I just want to tell you that this message must be heard today in the backdrop of last Sunday's message on stewardship. And I just want to remind those of you that weren't here, you haven't listened to the live stream of the podcast, those of you that are a part of Judah Church, those of you visiting, I'm good. But those of you that are a part of Judah Church, I'm asking you to go back and listen to that message. Because there is a transition that is taking place here. And this is a matter of stewardship. And businessmen understand the difference between having an owner and a steward. As a steward, it is my responsibility to make sure that I do what the owner wants done. It doesn't matter my opinion. It doesn't matter what I think would be in the best interest. The owner has given me something that belongs to him, and he's asked me to steward it as if it is mine, but remember, it's not yours. That's why your company car cannot be your vacation vehicle. Because it's yours, and I got all your McDonald's bags in it, but it's not yours. Yeah. So I want you to go back and listen to the stewardship, because you got to hear this message today in the backdrop of that God owns it all. You understand? God owns all of your money. He owns all of your house. He owns all of your relationships. He owns all of your businesses. He owns it all. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, and all that inhabit it and those that dwell therein, Psalm 24, verse 1. That it all belongs to God. And all these people are running around trying to make decisions for a world that is not theirs. And we're making decisions in our worlds as if our world is ours. Your home is not yours. Your job is not yours. As a matter of fact, the clothes on your back are not yours. He created the cotton that made the clothes. You are not yours. For you came from the dirt that he spoke into existence. Do you understand what I'm saying? Stewardship. We are stewards, not owners. Now, in that backdrop, let's go to Luke chapter number 9, verse number 12. Late in the day, the 12 approached him and said, "Send the crowd away so they can go into the surrounding villages and countryside to find food and lodging, because we are in a deserted place here." Now I want you to see something, because I'm going to do a little bit of expository today, but I'm really focusing on the meat of the message. I want you to see this, that the 12 disciples are in the same atmosphere and environment as everyone else. It is deserted. There's no food. There's no light. There's not this surplus of anything going on here. As a matter of fact, Jesus has come up and he's getting ready to preach to 5,000 men. Some theologians say there were over 20,000 because it was only the men that were counted in that day. And this story, if you've read the Bible at all, you know that there's this little boy with two fish and five loaves. Now he was not counted, but he was counted on. Hallelujah. But here are the 12 disciples in the same situation. They're in the deserted place. They have no food, just like everybody else. But the difference is they're connected to Jesus. So they go to the one that they know has the power to do anything and say, "Hey, look, we have got a problem here. All of these people are here, and they're asking us to feed them. And while you're teaching, because you preach too long, now they're all hungry, and they're trying to find Bojangles." Hallelujah. So the disciples go to Jesus and say, "What are we going to do about this? And here's my recommendation. Send them all the way. We do not have the infrastructure yet to house this mass of a multitude. Our organization and our structure is not organized or planned enough to the place that we can manage all of these needs. So, God, send them to another church. Send them to somewhere else that maybe has a bigger organization, a bigger structure, and maybe they can deal with what we can't." So I want you to see something. Consumers get meals, but it is the disciples who get the miraculous. We're going here. Consumers get meals, but a disciple gets used for the miraculous. I want you to understand, I'm telling you, we're turning the heat up. That's what we're doing. Not that we need to turn the heat up in here, oh my God. But we're turning the heat up. Consumers. Consumers struggle to be fed. But it is the disciple who struggles with how to feed. Oh God, here we go. Here we go. You ready? I just don't get fed here. I've got to transition because they're not feeding me. The problem is you've been in faith for 20 years and you're still acting like a consumer, not a disciple. The reason why you're not getting fed is because you're the one supposed to be doing the feeding. And if you're not in the kitchen cooking, that's the reason why everybody's starving. Oh, hey, hold up, wait a minute, put a little Jesus in it, you know what I'm saying? Hold up. How many of you have ever heard somebody say, I've got to leave, I'm just not getting fed anymore? Okay. Hallelujah. Could it be, can I go a little deeper? Could it be that the reason you're not getting fed anymore is because now I'm responsible to do all the cooking and all the cleaning and all the set, and now I can't stay in the kitchen long enough to do the proper cooking because I'm so busy cutting the grass too. Y'all ain't hearing what I'm saying today. So God called me to cook and now I'm the lawn care agency as well. Now I'm the one going to, oh God, have mercy. This is not about me, but I want you to understand the concept. Can't you see, those of you that have little kids, can't you see your kids sitting at the table complaining about you being busy? And then you come in and you've put in a hot pocket, something they could have done for themselves. And now they're complaining that you have given them a hot pocket when they could have got their hind end out the video game room, hallelujah, and went to the microwave themselves and cooked it themselves. But they're complaining about your lack of giving hot pockets because you were busy doing the things that only you can do. I'm preaching good today. Happy Father's Day. Hallelujah. You know what that's called? That's called teenage Christians who want all of the benefits of being in the house but want none of the responsibility for paying the bills. They want to be in the house, go into any room they want to at any time they want to, go into any cupboard they want to at any time they want to, 2 o'clock in the morning going into your pantry that you filled up from your money that you work for. Oh, I'm feeling better. Stay on the back row, son. I'm feeling better. Sitting on your blessed assurance, and then you're going to get an attitude because I asked you to take the trash. The devil is a lie. You a consumer. You're not a contributor. But it is the consumer who wants to be fed. It is the disciple who struggles with making sure everyone gets fed. Do you hear what I'm saying? I want you to hear it. 5,000 men are walking around going, I'm hungry, 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 I'm hungry. Mine, mine, mine. I'm hungry, I'm hungry, I'm hungry, I'm hungry. I'm hungry, I'm hungry, I'm hungry. But there are 12 going, how do we feed them? 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 And there's only one out of all those thousands of people going, I know how to feed them. 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 12 are running to the one with the solution. The other 5,000 are running around screaming about the problem. Here we go. All right. Verse 13. You give them something to eat. Listen to what Jesus said. You give them something to eat. We have no food. We have no resources. There's nothing going on. We do not have the organization or the infrastructure to manage this amount of need. Yet Jesus is saying, you give each one according to his own ability. You, I see you as someone who has the power to perform the need, the miracle that is needed in this need. I see your ability in this situation to meet this need. Otherwise, I would have never put you in the situation of the need. You didn't hear what I said. Next Sunday, there's going to be a 6'10", where's he from? Nigerian, sitting right here. 6'10". Big old joker from Nigeria. I love to hear him talk. We're sitting in front of the school principal going, he has nowhere to go. He's here on a visa. He has nowhere to go. And him and I are having this conversation going, we need one more thing to do. That's what we need. I mean, I'm sitting around busy. I don't have anything to do for about 45 minutes a day. One more thing to do. I need one more mouth to feed. 6'10" Nigerian mouth to feed. And we're sitting there. After last week's message, we're still in the valley of decision. And I looked at him and I said, do we have the ability? There's a need in front of us. Do we have the ability? We have a lot of excuses and good, justifiable reasons not to. But do we have the ability to make this boy's life better because of his encounter with us? Yes or no? Yes, yes, yes. Each one according to his ability. So when he comes here Sunday, he's my son. His name is Chisholm. And I expect him to go to the NBA and pay me back. I'm sorry, I went past it for a minute. I'm just being practical. Put that on the count. You give them something to eat. In other words, stop asking me to do things you can do yourself. I have presented you the need because I believe you already have the power to resolve it. I would have never brought the need in front of you if I did not believe that you had the power within you to meet the need. What would happen if we saw every obstacle as an opportunity to demonstrate just how powerful God is inside of us? We told them, but he told them, we have no more than 5 loaves and 2 fish, and they said, unless we go and buy food for all these people. Limited resource, so now we need to go spend some money. Verse 14, for about 5,000 men were there, I just talked about that, and then he told his disciples, have them sit down in groups of about 50 each. You see the masses, you want to see the end result, but God is saying, take your God-sized dream and put it in man-sized steps. Feed 50. And when we get done feeding those 50, let's feed the next 50. And then the next 50. Let's get 50 in Judah Kids. And let's get 50 in the tribe. And let's get 50 on the praise team. You understand what I'm saying? Never mind the 5,000s with the knees. Let's just go 50 by 50 in every department. Y'all hear what I'm saying? That's dream team stuff right there. Let's get the greeters at running 50. You understand what I'm saying? Let's get the setup team with 50 people. Yes. Some of y'all shouting, y'all ain't never come up with setup. Y'all ain't never here at 7:30. You're going to lie and go to hell on Father's Day. You better hope Jesus don't return. Talk about setup. Yeah, 50 people. You the one. Start with you. I'm just kidding. I'm teasing. Let's sit them down in 50, sort of. Verse number 15. So they did so and had them all sit down. And then he took the fish, the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, and looking up to heaven, he blessed and broke them. He kept giving them to the disciples to set before the crowd. And verse number 17, everyone ate and was filled. And then they picked up 12 baskets of leftover pieces. Now, I want to give you the power of giving. This is the meat of the message today. Here's the power of giving. Power of giving, principle number one. It has to be blessed before it will ever be multiplied. One of the prophetic words the Lord gave me, that out of this room, multimillionaires would be birthed. Birthed. Okay? And some of you, you're hearing prosperity, you don't know me. I believe in the prosperity gospel. I just believe that you will prosper as your soul prospers. That's what I believe. He told me that they would be birthed out of here. That it wasn't about multimillionaires coming. It was about multimillionaires being birthed and then extending. But it has to be blessed before it can be multiplied. Most of us have seen addition and subtraction in our finances and our lives. But have any of us ever really, really seen the power of multiplication? Where God takes something that is not enough and so multiplies it that it becomes more than enough. This principle happens because He blesses it. I hear you. The blessing of the Lord maketh one rich, and He adds no sorrow to it. And I'm not talking about just your money, but I'm talking about rich in a marriage. Rich with relationships with your children. I'm talking about rich in your relationships with friends and family members. I'm talking, the blessings of the Lord makes one rich in every, I don't want to just be rich in finances, because I know that you can get rich, but there's sorrow added to that wealth. I don't want to just have a lot of money. I want to be rich in every way. But God cannot multiply what He does not get to bless. And Joshua mentioned it. For us financially, it's about the tithe. Hebrews chapter 7, just in case you didn't think that the New Testament deals with tithing. Hebrews chapter 7, verse number 8. The tenth is collected by people who die. That's me. I collect it, but you do not give it to me. You understand what I'm saying? You're not giving your tithe to a church. I'm the bank. And I will absolutely have to keep a record, and I will stand with account for every dollar that is collected here on behalf of you. But the collector is going to die. But the one who receives it is declared to be living by Him. You tithe to Jesus. You're tithing to Jesus. Now, okay, here's why. Because God cannot bless what's not put in His hands first. See, we want to spend and then ask God to bless it. God said, put it in my hands and I will bless it, and you don't have to worry about the spending side of it. Tithe, it's the tithe. Now, just in case you're hearing just money today, it's not about just money. But I'm also talking about you giving a tithe of your time and a tithe of your talent and a tithe of your treasure as well. It's about a tithe of every dimension. You are three-dimensional. All three dimensions God should get a tithe of. He should get a tithe of your body. He should get a tithe of your mind. And He should get some tithe of your spirit. I mean, that's why we come to church, not just watch it on TV. Because we're coming to the house of the Lord. That's the point of it. That you and I are not to forsake the assembling thereof when we see the day approaching. And just in case you haven't been watching news lately, the day is quickly approaching. And He said, you and I should assemble more. And what we've done is we have diluted the assembling of the saints to a Sunday morning only. Maybe. That's why we have to do live stream. I'm about to get in trouble. Because our vacation is more important than the God we tithe. And I'm not fussing, I have no axe to grind. I'm grateful. Trust me, in a few days, in a couple weeks, I'm gonna go on vacation. But I have to be back. Not because it's my job. I don't have to, I get to. I don't wanna miss. That's me. Okay, I need to move on. Let me, because I'm still building. Leviticus 27:30. A tithe of everything from the land, whether grain from the soil or fruit from the trees, belongs to the Lord. It is holy. It is the tithe that blesses the other 90%. And my brother said it so beautifully in his finance class. You can be 90% blessed, or you can be 100% cursed. It belongs to the Lord. It is holy. Listen to what He says. Stewardship, got to hear it in the backdrop of stewardship. It belongs to the Lord. In other words, tithing is not giving, it's returning. Hallelujah. Tithing is not giving, it's returning. if it already belongs to him, I'm not giving it to him, I'm returning it. Tithing is not giving, it's returning. So here's the power of giving principle number two, and there's only two principles today. I want to make sure we stay with time. Number two, it has to be given a way to be multiplied. Did you see it in the backdrop of the text? It was only until they gave it away that it was multiplied. It was only until they took the time to give it. It's one thing to put it in God's hands and have him bless it, because it cannot multiply unless it's blessed. But when it multiplied was not in the blessing, it was in the giving away. You're not hearing what I'm saying. We come and we return to God our offerings, time, talent, and treasure, marriages, relationships. We return it all to God, and we think because it's blessed, it's multiplied. But the multiplication doesn't take place at the blessing. Otherwise, supernaturally, fishes and loaves would have manifested everywhere in the hands of Jesus. But it wasn't in Jesus' hands that it multiplied. It was in Jesus' hands that it was blessed. Where it became multiplied is when disciples, not consumers, began to give it away. Consumers started getting, but disciples started giving. Oh, I'm about to, oh God, I feel the Holy Ghost. I feel the Holy Ghost. Matthew 6:21, because I hear violation right here. Listen to this. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Now, most of us see that scripture and read, where your heart is, there your treasure will be. It's not it. Where your treasure is, your heart follows. Most of us want somebody to pull our heartstrings to make us give. And what God is saying is where you give, there your heart will go. In other words, where you give determines where your heart goes, not the reverse. If you hate church, start tithing and giving, and your heart will show up. If you hate your marriage, start making an investment in your wife and your heart will show up. Most of you want to have your heart there and then you give a gift. That's not how it works. You give gifts, you make treasure, you put your deposit, and sooner or later your heart will go where your pocketbook has already been. You hear what I'm saying this morning? For where your treasure is, present tense, there your heart will be, future tense also. In other words, my heart is following my giving. What I love about this statement that God gives us is that I'm not to give emotionally. I keep waiting on somebody to pull at my heart. Well, I can manipulate you every Sunday, trust me. I've been in this game long enough to know how to take up an offering. And look, I got a concealed carry permit. In other words, I pack more than the praise. You understand what I'm saying? I mean, we can take up an offering. I can walk down to Bank of America right now and I will receive an offering. You understand? Please don't put that on the recording. Because watch this, let me hurry. And some of you that come out of different camps, and if you've been in church long, you know what I mean. There's this prosperity gospel camp. You know, and I'm not going to name the denomination and all that stuff. And today's prosperity gospel says this. I hate it. You can go ahead and put it. I hate it because the byproduct is you give to get. And when you get, arrogance and pride and selfish ambition shows up. So I'm going to give to God. and I'm going to pull this lucky lottery lever. And if you sow a seed, God will give you a Bentley. And if you put in this offering, I'm going to send you some water with a green handkerchief that I blew my nose in. And your healing is attached. You get because you give. I mean, we see it over and over again, but I want you to see this in 2 Corinthians 9:6. Remember this. Remember this. Hear me now. Remember this. The person who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And the person who sows generously will also reap generously. And, oh God, do not limit this to money. If you sow sparingly into your marriage, you're going to wonder why you get no harvest from it. But if you generously give to your marriage, you know what I'm saying? This is the power of giving. The multiplication is in the giving. Each person, watch this, verse 7, should do as he has decided in his heart. For where your treasure is, there your heart is also. Not reluctantly or out of necessity. Watch this. For God loves a cheerful giver. Buckner said to me today, earlier this week, but he'll take it from a grouch. He loves a cheerful giver, but he'll take it from a grouch. But hear the power of that. He'll take it from the grouch. Maybe those of us are struggling with God's love because we're not givers. Because God loves active action verb. God loves a cheerful giver. I hear you. Because most of us heard that statement, heard that verse, and we hear, oh, God appreciates a cheerful giver. Oh, I love you like ice cream and my puppy. But what he's saying is, I will actively demonstrate my love because of the cheer of your giving. But watch how he does it. Oh, God. And is able to make every grace overflow to you. Every grace you need will be an overflow to your life when you cheerfully give. Watch this, verse number one, in every way, always having everything you need so that you may excel in every good work. All of my ways, all of my needs, and everything I put my hand to, I excel in when it is a good work because I am a cheerful giver. This is so good. Luke chapter 6, verse 38. I'm almost done. Give and it will be given to you. Did you hear that? Give and it will be given to you. Most of us are waiting to get before we give. The prosperity gospel message, I didn't finish it. The prosperity gospel message says, give to get. But the principle that Jesus teaches is you give to give. I just want to be very clear with everybody in this room. I want to make a lot of money. I got one amen. I want to make a lot. I'm telling you, I do. I want to make a lot of money. Not so that I can have a Mercedes or a Porsche with apostle on the back. So I can roll up here and let everybody, that's not the point for me. I got 40 boys in Honduras. There's going to be 6 more orphanages around this world before this thing is over with. I'm assuming that Nigeria being in my house is a representation of the next continent I'm going to. We are going to. I feel like he is the first fruits of many sons. You understand what I'm saying? That's how I feel in my spirit. But you do not get and then give. He said, give and it will be given to you. In good measure, pressed down, shaken together, shall men give to your bosom. Watch this. It will be poured out in your life. For with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. In other words, if you're giving in a teaspoon, don't expect God to give back in a shovel. But if I'm giving in a shovel, God's giving back. For in the measure I use, that's the measuring stick God uses too. Give, and it will be given. The multiplication is in the giving. Watch this. We must do our part, and then God does his part. You hear it? I've got to do my part, and then God will do his part. Watch this. You will lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. He didn't say they shall recover and then go lay hands on them. You go do your part, give, and then I will give back to you in good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. I've got to do my part. God will do his part. Most of us are waiting on God to do his part while God is waiting on us to do ours. He looked at Moses, and Moses is saying, I got all this stuff that I'm having to deal with, all this stuff that's insurmountable in my life. What am I going to do? And God looked at him a very powerful principle. He said, what, Moses, is in your hand? You're telling me about the need and insurmountable obstacles. What I want to know is, what do you have a grasp on? Well, let's start right there. For whatever is in your hand, that's what I'm going to use to make the miracle. And he parted waters and began to feed with manna from heaven and cloud by day and fire by night because of what he decided to give God that was already in his hand. God didn't give him that stick. Moses gave God that stick. So, okay, Pastor, tithing is returning, not giving. So how do I know when to give? You ready? It's real simple. You know, if you know his voice, he'll tell you when. He'll tell you when to give. It will become blazingly obvious. It will become abundantly apparent. He will put a need in front of you. And if you know his voice, he'll tell you when to do it. That's why we don't have to be emotional. And I don't have to be manipulative. If you know his voice, he'll tell you. All right, I'm done. In 2 Chronicles, it gives us an account of Solomon. Solomon issued as the wisest man in all the world. This is one of the things that baffled me as I began to become a student of the Word. Why would a man who has an opportunity to get anything ask for wisdom? I mean, it preaches real good. But the practicality of that makes no sense to me at all. And if you have all the wisdom in the world, why did you have 600 wives and concubines? I mean, I'm doing good to manage one. You understand what I'm saying? I mean, I got married and I didn't realize I didn't even know how to tie my shoe. You understand? That's unbelievable. I'm just being silly. Listen to what he says. That night God appeared to Solomon and said, ask what I should give you. God looks at a man and says, whatever you want, I'll give you. Just ask. What I want to know is why. Why did Solomon get that kind of deal? 2 Chronicles 1:7. How does a man like Solomon get that kind of deal? Where God comes in, who owns everything, says, whatever you want, I'll give to you. Just ask. Ask it. It's yours. Well, you don't get 2 Chronicles chapter 1, verse 7 without 2 Chronicles chapter 1, verse 6. And here's what it says. Solomon offered sacrifices there in the Lord's presence on the bronze altar at the tent of meetings. He offered, here it is, 1,000 burnt offerings. Jewish traditions at the inauguration of a new king would offer one burnt offering. It was Jewish tradition for the king to step into his place and offer one burnt offering before God. Solomon offered 1,000. You ready? Wore me out. God only asks extravagant givers, what do you want? He gave them 1,000 times more than expectations. He did not give him the minimum required. He gave him 1,000 times more. Oh. May he increase us 1,000 times more than what we are and fulfill every promise that he... 1,000 times more is what I'm asking. But is 1,000 times more what I'm giving? Because God only asks, what do you want? To an extravagant giver. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Blessed be the name of the Lord. So, on Father's Day, we had our moment with the men. But I want to ask every father to meet me in this front. Every father. Every father. Every father. Biological or not, doesn't matter to me. Every father. I father kids. I know it's not mine. But they're mine. Every father. Every father. Now, every man behind the fathers. Every man behind the fathers. I'd like every man behind the fathers. Every person that goes into the men's bathroom. I don't care how you feel today. You just, whatever. Whatever. I'm about to get in trouble. Don't pull me into politics. Don't pull me into politics. Do me a favor. Tim, come down here, son. Just set the stage, Chandler. I want you down here as well. Yep. Y'all give every Sunday. This is a moment. You and I must lead the way in our giving. Let's lead the way in our giving. Scanning the front. There's some of us that had it modeled in front of us and others of us that didn't. Some had it modeled early and then not so much. Some had incredible grandparents, grandfathers. Others, man, you are the Abraham of your family. And you're learning to serve a God that you don't even know. Setting up the generations to come. But no matter the case, we must take our place. We must take our place. He created you as a man. But he has also demanded us as men to be givers. And just so we're clear, I'm not about to take up another offering. But some of us, fathers, have just been doing our returns. You understand what I'm saying? We say we give them a house to live in. No, that's minimum requirement stuff. Well, I mean, I'm not cheating on you. That's minimum requirement stuff. How much are you giving? Or, like the challenge for me, I'm convicted, I need to be down in the front. Or do we give our best to our job and not our marriage? Do we give our best to our home, to our job or to our friends and not our children? This is the challenge that God is laying down for all of us, to be courageous, courageous leaders. I'm going to play a little video clip, And then we're going to pray and we're going to get right up out of here. Because I know some of y'all are going to get some good home cooking from Zaxby's. Watch this with me. Watch this with me.
Thanking for your faith and your families was almost overwhelming. Nathan, I'd like for you to come and stand before me, and your wife and children to stand beside me. My son in the faith, I took joy in mentoring you as a young man, and today I take joy in blessing you as a godly father. Are you ready to make this commitment before God and your family?
Yes, I am.
Then I'd like for you to repeat after me. I, Nathan Hayes, do solemnly resolve before God.
I, Nathan Hayes, do solemnly resolve before God.
To take full responsibility for myself, my wife, and my children.
That I would take full responsibility for myself, my wife, and my children.
I will love them, protect them, and serve them.
I will love them, protect them, and serve them.
And teach them the statutes of God as the spiritual leader of my home.
And teach them the statutes of God as the spiritual leader of my home.
I will be faithful to my wife, to love and honor her.
I'll be faithful to my wife, to love and honor her.
And be willing to lay down my life for her as Christ did for me.
And be willing to lay down my life for her as Christ did for me.
I will teach my son to love God with all of his heart, all of his mind, and all of his strength.
I will teach my son to love God with all of his heart, all of his mind, and all of his strength.
And I will train him to honor authority and live responsibly.
I will train him to honor authority and to live responsibly.
I will confront evil, pursue justice, and love mercy.
I will treat others with kindness, respect, and compassion.
I will work diligently, provide for the needs of my family.
I will forgive those who have wronged me and reconcile with those who I have wronged.
I will walk in integrity as a man answerable to God.
I will seek to honor God, obey his word, and do his will.
For me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
Now that each of you has committed to live by this resolution, I bless you in the name of the Lord. But I also have a warning for each of you. Now that you know what you are to do and have committed to do it before God and these witnesses, you are doubly accountable. Let me also assure you that you may have confidence in this resolution and your resolve now. Because as you stand here, there's no challenge, no controversy, and no conflict. But I can assure you that challenges will arise, conflicts will arise, and controversy will arise. It is at that moment that in order to live out this resolution, you will need courage. Courage, courage.
So what I'm going to do in 1 Timothy is that every man at every part would pray, lifting holy hands without anger or wrath, depending on what translation. Today, I'm going to give every father a resolution. And after I run out of those, every future father a resolution. You can hang it up on your wall like they did if you want to. But a picture on a wall easily gets forgotten because it becomes so common. But today, the gauntlet that God has laid down in front of us to run is that we will be responsible to give in every way. I was in a counseling session with a husband struggling in his marriage. And I told him, I said, stand with me all over the room if you're physically able. If you're physically able. He was struggling in his marriage. And I said, you want me to tell you the scripture that bothers me the most? I'll tell you one of the hardest scriptures for me as a man, as a father, as a husband. The Bible says, I'm to love my wife as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. And I'm always reminded when conflict comes, and those of you that never have conflict in your marriage, I would submit to you that you're single. That's pretty funny. That's pretty funny. I said, here's my struggle. Until I have been stripped naked, been beaten with a cat of nine tails, and my back is completely lacerated to the point my entrails are exposed, pierced in my hands, and then stabbed in my ribs, with a mockery of a crown on my head, exposed to the world for their laughter while they're playing games in my pain. I haven't done enough. I haven't taken enough. I do not get to say I quit until all of this has happened to me. When God finally put that in me, I stopped carrying my cross of martyrdom. Well, I don't get any respect around here. Well, y'all don't appreciate me. Well, y'all don't understand what I give. And if he can stand before his judge and jury with silence and follow through with his word, it's my desire to do the same. So Vince, Jason, if you'll help me, fathers first, and those of you that see yourself as future fathers, those of you that are fathers in the faith, whether by, you know, whether they're your actual children or not, you see yourself that way. I'm gonna put the scroll in your hand, and it's a sign of responsibility. Can I just hear people behind us just praying right now? Just praying right now. Half the problems of the generation that's coming behind us is because fathers are not praying. They're not lifting hands. They're angry. And they want to fight. They want to argue their position. They're angry. I pray that the spirit of anger would be removed from every man. Oh God, I feel your presence. We uproot the spirit of anger. And we say today that mad men are not here anymore. Father, we solemnly take our place. You trusted us to be a man. We lead the way in our giving of our time, of our talents, of our treasures to the areas of our life that you have allowed us to be rulers of, the gardens of Edens in our own lives. We take our place today. We take our place today. We take our place today. Come on, men, if you have your scroll, I want you just to pray for a minute. Make a commitment. Confirm your place to the Father who created you to be in that place. God, we thank you. We thank you. Make sure Chad gets one. Make sure Miles gets one. Father, we thank you. We thank you for the awesome responsibility you have laid upon us. We take our place. We take our place as leaders, as givers, as stewards. And you will get a return with interest. I'm looking at 5 talent men, God, make them 10. I'm looking at 2 talent men, make them 4, God. Maybe there's one that feels like a 1 talent person, God. Don't let them be afraid without fear, God. Let them don't be afraid. You made your investment because you trusted us. We are your bank. We trust you. We give so that it can be given back to us, Lord. We do not give to get. We give to give. We give to give. We give to give. The more you give, the more we'll give. We're conduits for you, God. Send the currency of the kingdom through our lives, through our hands, through our finances, through our marriage. Send the currency of the kingdom through our children. Send the currency of the kingdom, God. It's what we long for. It's what we desire. Come on, come on. Come on. Just one time, say,
I give myself away.
Oh God,
I give myself away.
Why?
So you can use me.
I give myself.
Give myself away. Oh, yeah. I give myself away. So
yeah,
you
my life.
Can use
my life is not my own. Stay.
My life is not. I give myself to you. Oh, my life is not my own.
To you.
To you I belong. I give myself. I give myself to you.
I give myself.
I give myself away.
Every man in the next 24 hours, I want you to take 1 Timothy chapter 2 verse 8 and I want you to put it somewhere of prominence for you. I don't care where it is. I don't care if it's on your mirror. I don't, a post-it note, put a little message in your car where you're driving. But this is the mantra of manhood. That every man in every place would pray. Pray in every place. Lift your hands in every place. Refuse to be angry in every place. And refuse to get in arguments in every... That this is the mantle. This is what we are seeking to do as men. That I want men in every place to pray, lifting holy hands without anger or argument. According to your word in Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 11. I say, Father, make us 1,000 times more than what we are and fulfill every promise that you have given us. We ask these things in the matchless name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, and soon coming King. And all of God's people said amen. Amen.
You have just seen the Word of God, I pray, come alive. And I don't want to leave this moment. I didn't want to leave you leaving this video without a moment for you to maybe make Jesus Christ the Lord and Savior of your life. It's real simple. All you have to do is ask Him to come into your life, believe that He is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and confess your need from Him and the fact that you've been far from Him. And today I pray that that would happen and take place in your life. But before you leave, I also wanted to do one thing that we do at the conclusion of every service, which is speak the Deuteronomy 1:11 blessing over your life. And I say, may the God of your fathers make you 1,000 times more than what you are and fulfill every promise that He has given you. We love you. God bless you. We hope you check out more videos. And if there's anything we can ever do, please email us at info@judahchurch.org.